Good morning, everyone. We've just been waiting for my colleague Dan Rundy to join us. I think he's 1 minute. Okay, if please be patient with us, and we'll begin. Let's start then. My name's Jennifer Cook. I'm director of the Africa program here at CSIS. Welcome to everybody, and a special welcome to our guest today, Dr. Abdoulaye Dukule. We're here today to talk about the Common African Position on the Post-2015 Development Agenda. This is a set of agreements that was adopted in January of this year, launched in February of 2014 in N'Djamena, Chad. A set of principles that was developed in a broad and participatory process whose focus really was to give African voices, government leaders, citizens, private sector, legislatures, and regional stakeholders a greater voice in laying out a global development agenda, a global agenda, but also an agenda for Africa. For over a decade, here's my colleague Dan Rundy, I'll introduce in a moment. No problem. For over a decade, that global development agenda has been really shaped to a large degree by the Millennium Development Goals, and I think most of you are familiar with them. 8 international development goals established at the Millennium Summit of the UN in 2000. All members of the UN at that time, all 189 of them, agreed to those principles, and I'll just run through them briefly. As I say, I think most of you know them: eradicate extreme poverty and hunger, achieve universal primary education, to promote gender equality, reduce child mortality, to improve maternal health, to combat HIV/AIDS, malaria, and other diseases, to ensure environmental sustainability, and to develop a global partnership for development. I think the MDGs have seen a lot of success in setting these big, ambitious, aspirational targets on some of the major human development challenges, kind of as a motivator and an incentive and something of a measurement. There are some critiques on that for progress. But they've also been criticized for being particularly for being heavily focused on kind of the external element and external interventions and external funding, and not focused more, let's say, on the needs of African citizens rather than on building their capacities and kind of working on their aspirations. So we're going to hear today from Dr. Abdoulaye Dukule, who is the President of Liberia, Ellen Sirleaf Johnson's special envoy for the post-2015 agenda. He's also head of the Secretariat for the MDGs. He's here today to present the Common African Position, why it's different from the MDGs, what motivated it, and kind of what are the next steps in bringing this to fruition. It's a real particular pleasure today to introduce Dr. Dukule. He's an old and very dear friend of mine. We met on a Voice of America program in the midst of the Liberian war. We're talking about Charles Taylor at the time. Abdoulaye is a man of many hats. He's a filmmaker, a writer, a journalist. He wrote some brilliant analysis and captured some of the stories of the Civil War and the aftermath in really a very poignant way. And it's just such a pleasure to see him now kind of working on on building Africa and building Liberia towards the future and kind of on the recovery and reconstruction. So it's a real pleasure to see him again and see him doing this important work. I'm going to turn over briefly to my colleague Dan, who's been doing more on the MDGs than I have, but I couldn't miss this opportunity to see Abdoulaye. So Dan, why don't we turn to you, and then we'll turn to
Dr. Dukule. I'll be brief, and I apologize for being late. Mr. Dukule, thanks for being here. I'm a great admirer of Ellen Johnson Sirleaf's. I had the pleasure of meeting her a couple of years ago. I think that the high-level panel, of which she was one of the point people on, I suspect you had something to do with that as well. I think the report that came out a year ago is an excellent report. I think reflects, obviously, Liberia's experience and her experience and her aspirations for the future. I thought that what I think is particularly interesting about that report is the reflection on the changed world that the high-level panel saw from the year 2000 in terms of the role of investment, the cost and impact of conflict on development, which is, I'm sure, you know quite well, but also the opportunities around the role of investment and trade, as well as domestic resource mobilization, which encompasses both in local investment, but also includes the ability of countries to pay for their own development through tax revenues as well, and I know that's something that's of great importance. I also think that what I took away from the high-level panel report is that aid as serving as a catalyst, as a supporting actor in other folks' central act of development, if you will. And I know that we're coming to a point soon on the post-2015 development agenda where there's been the high-level panels sent their report in, the Secretary General sent their report back. There's been a whole series of conversations around what's called the open working group process. So collaborative is probably, it's collaborative in capital letters, I think, is in, everyone's had a chance to weigh in. But at some point, there's gonna have to be a small group that's gonna go off into a room somewhere and have a real political process, because you can't have 35 of these goals. I do think by UN standards, I think the MDGs have been an excellent way, a form of organizing principles, though I would say that my sense is much of the progress that's been made on the MDGs has been because of growth in China or India or some specific targeted social program spending in places like Brazil, though I think assistance has had a role in it, though I think there have been these other factors that have been as or much more important, frankly. And so I do think we don't want to screw up something that's been pretty good. You had 8 simple organizing principles, and so whether it's 12 or whether it's 13, I'm not sure the traffic can bear too many more than that. And so one of the questions I've been asking people, and I hope you'll answer, is when I've met with various folks, whether it's the Japanese or whether it's the Canadians or whether it's the US or the Brits, I've said, what are your pet rocks? What are your pet rocks going into this process? A very idiomatic American term. What are you going to fight for? What is Africa going to fight for in terms of whether it's 2 or 3 additional things, or what are the things it wants to keep in this process? Because there is going to be a political moment, and I know that's partially why I suspect you're in town, is we're coming upon that political moment. So it's really a pleasure to have you, and I think the fact that the room is full and we've got so much interest, I think, reflects the fact that this is Africa's moment as well. And so we're so pleased that you're here, and it's very nice to meet you. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone, and I'm very pleased to be here. To start with your first questions, I think the problem responding to what the MDGs did for Africa, I think it is very simple. It's galvanized and focused our attention on major development issues. The downside of it was that it was externally driven.
Yeah.
So, by 2010, the head of states of Africa met at the African Union in Kampala. And during that meeting, they decided that, well, the MDGs will expire in 4 or 5 years. We have to be prepared to know what, we have to be prepared, and we have to have something to say in the success, whatever happened after that. And they decided that, well, we'll set up a system, we'll set up a thinking group to start thinking about how do we go into the post 2015, how does Africa go into the post 2015, and how does Africa take care of what has changed on the continent, because a lot of things have changed, not only in Africa since the 2000 MDGs, but around the world. So they started working through multilaterals, having consultations on the ground in every country on the continent. And last year, finally, in May, they decided that, well, now has come the time to put all these ideas together, reduce all these millions of priorities that every country had sent to the AU, to UNICA, to UNFPA, and say, how do we now put these things into a framework that will only not only reflect Africa's priority, but also see how we can negotiate with the rest of the globe. because the post-2015, whatever it is has to be participatory. And we're lucky, as an envoy of the president, to be part of that process, to be part of the process of the UN development, UN post-2015 consultations at a high-level panel that had 24 members from different parts of the world, and also co-chaired by Indonesia and Britain. Just the same week we handed over to the Secretary General our report on HLP, the AU met and decided that, well, it's the time to create this group. Instead of creating a group of experts, which was the case of the MDGs, they say we'll start with the political process. Mm-hmm. We will nominate a few head of states, so they decided to pick two head of state from each of the economic regions of Africa, two from West Africa, Guinea and Liberia, two from North Africa, Mauritania and Algeria, two from Central Africa, Ethiopia and Mauritius. You had Eastern Africa, Chad and Congo, and Southern Africa, we have South Africa and Namibia. And we set up a secretariat at the seat of the AU in Addis, and the president was named to chair the process. And we have been having meetings, and the big problem was to how do you reduce the 36 or 70 priorities that we thought people had come up with into workable framework. After many meetings, the first one of the HLC, the High Level Committee of Head of States, was held in New York in September in the margins of the UN. The first thing we did was to draw down the idea of priorities. So let's see what are the issues that are cut crossing around the continent. What are the main issues? So we came up with five pillars. The five pillars that sort of will be the engine for the development in Africa, but also serve as our entry into the world, our part of the dialogue, participate in the dialogue on the development process. Where is the world going? And it was not just about Africa's priorities, but it was also looking at where the world is going, what kind of world do we want to live in, and what kind of partnership do we want to create, to establish. I think one of the biggest problem, I won't say the problem, but one of the downside of the MDGs was that the partnership was not taken where it was supposed to go. So therefore, we thought partnership becomes an important aspect of the whole process. Among our five pillars, we had structural economic transformation and inclusive growth. This was very important. It was important to the president. She said it during the HLP process. She kept repeating it that no matter what you do, no matter how you want to deal with social issues, if you don't deal with the economic factor, you still have problems, because that is the source of inclusion. That's the source of exclusion. That's where people are excluded. That's where people that feel that they're not part of the process, and therefore, it was very important to have economic transformation, not only in Liberia, in Africa, but also around the world. I think the global crisis that we all experienced in the last 5 years showed clearly that we are all interlinked. Something happened in Iceland, and then boomerang into housing, and then from the housing to the banking system. And some countries are still failing, especially countries coming out of conflict like Liberia. The second issue was science and technology and innovation, that if you need to create a new sort of economic order, you have to have people who are able to sit and think and say, what are our natural capacities? What do we have on the ground in Africa? And how do we transform Africa itself from within without expecting every day somebody coming from outside to tell you, this is what you need to do, this is how you define development, this is how you define science, but can we have homegrown science? Can we have homegrown innovations? Can we have homegrown technology that deal with our issues so we become participant in a global process from an African perspective, but not simply sitting there and be at the receiving end of issues? The third one was people-centered development, that the means and ends of all development issues should be what you call a human being. That include health. I remember in the MDGs we were talking about education for all. I think in many countries in Africa, we have had up to 80-90% of achievement in that goal, but the quality of education becomes an issue. Say, how do we create quality education? Not just putting kids in the street, taking the kids out of the street and put them in a classroom, but providing quality education that allows them to be able to prepare for themselves for a decent life, get good jobs, and be able to live as a human being. And also that human-centered development also take another perspective, that back 20 years ago when we were talking about development, it was more like, how many white elephants can you build? Like a big house, big hotels that nobody can stay in, or highways into the desert. But now we're saying development is about simple little things. People being able to have clean water, mothers not dying by giving birth, children not dying of malaria after 6 months of life. Being able to have to go to school, not working, people not having to walk 10 miles to go to a primary school where there's no teacher or there's no classroom, and that kind of thing. So you have to refocus development on those basic issues, basic healthcare, basic education, and basic needs, taking care of transportation. And that includes also migration. How do you stop people from creating more ghettos and slums into the cities because there's nothing else, there's nothing to do in the village? So how do you urbanize, quote unquote, urbanize the village so that people don't have to rush into the city? Number four was environmental sustainability, natural resource management, and disaster risk management. And this is very important for Africa because if you look back into history, maybe going even back to 400 years ago, that Africa has served as a place where things are taken from, either human beings or resources, gold, diamonds, slavery, everything else. So how do we change that process? And we can't do it alone. We have to work with other people to do it. And also climate change. We say that Africa has an issue with climate change. We are facing the consequences of what is happening around the globe, but we have not created the problem that we face. Although we are part of the solution, we want to be part of the solution, we want to negotiate with people and how to mitigate climate change, knowing pretty well that we are not the primary responsible of climate change, and that it has happened before we even got into this point of development. I'm passing on and financing and partnership. Sometimes when we talk about Africa in terms of development, we think about somebody coming in with a bank book to write your check, or somebody coming in with a factory and say, okay, if you do this, you may do that. But we are saying, can we change that model? Can we have homegrown economies that take care, first of all, of African needs? And how do you do that? And how do you transform your own economy? And how do you finance that? And as you were saying, taxation, mobilization of local resources, that there are a lot of resources in Africa that have not been tapped, maybe because we have always looked at outsiders to come with solutions, so therefore we pay little attention to our own potentials, and that had to change. That will change also I can give you an example. Africa receives somewhere between $50 to $60 billion a year in ODA, what I call official development aid. But at the same time, $300 to $400 billion fly out, legally or illegally. And I remember three days ago, I was listening to NPR. The Secretary of Commerce of the U.S. was talking about how do we stop companies from moving their headquarters into other countries so they don't pay taxes in the U.S. Well, so we have something in common. We both have to fight these things. So how do we fight capital flight to make sure that people working on your land or people who are exploiting your resources pay the due taxes so that they don't come up and say, oh, we need a tax break for 5 years. And at the end of the 5 years, they have made enough money to move out to the next country next door and start the same process. And this has been going on in Africa for a long time. They have companies that work in Liberia. They get tax break for 5-6 years. At the end of the 6 years, they have enough money to go to Sierra Leone to say, hey, you know, we have new ideas. We can probably do this. So how do we stop doing that? And also the money that go from African economies are going to tax havens. Don't usually go to another African country. They go to Europe, they come to American banks, they go to the Caymans or whatever you know. They go around. So how do we create a new partnership where financing partnership really is partnership, not what we have this old concept of you are my partner, but I decide what you do. I decide what is on the table. I decide what is, you know, feasible and what is not feasible. And here we're talking about next week, 2 weeks from now, the African presidents will be talking to the president of the U.S., and I think AGOA 1, AGOA 2 will be part of the discussions. But these are issues that we need to talk about, that, you know, if we talk about partnership, it's not about you deciding as a big brother what is good for your market and what is good for my market at the same time. That means that there's no partnership. It's a big brother, small brother thing. So that mentality has to change. And can we change that? And we think that, you know, it's possible to change. We think that Africa has changed in terms of governance, in terms of being able to know what their resources are, and in terms of the whole global outlook, that the economies that were powerful yesterday are no longer powerful. Russia is not the same Russia that was there 10, 15, 20 years ago. China is no longer the same China. Clean air is, you know, everybody's problem. And I think these are the issues, but I gave you five, but there's a sixth one that came in at the Africa Summit in June, and that was peace and security. Before the head of state adopted the document, they said, we like what you have, we like what the committee has done, but there's one important aspect of issues in Africa that we need to tackle, that is peace and security. That if you don't have peace, if you don't have security, whatever you do is blown out of the window. And I'll give you a good example of Sudan, South Sudan. Everybody was so excited about South Sudan being independent, the end of the war in Sudan, one of the longest war of all time in Africa. And the African Development Bank went and invested something like $400 million into infrastructure. But now what is left are probably the old cars, the burned down cars. The $400 million investment that went in there is all going through the window. So without peace, without security, you're not going to be able to do anything. Our problem with that was that, well, the problem we face is that there is a group of people at the UN, of nations that control peace and security around the world. They shut down the peace and security discussion when we were talking about at the high level panel under the UN sponsorship. They said, no, you can't talk about peace and security. This is part of the Security Council mandate. Therefore, whatever you do, just stay away. Talk about safety, human safety, talk about other things. But peace and security in the same sentence, no, you cannot use that. And in Africa, we say, well, we are 27% of the UN. So we will talk about it. And we put in our mandate. We'll put in our agenda. How we negotiate around it, in what term it will come up when the political discussions start, that's a different thing. But we did, but it's not, we don't also see peace in terms of boots on the ground, that you need to have jets flying over to go square a conflict. By the time the Security Council votes to send troops to any conflict, you already have thousands of dead people, and mostly young people, women, children, the most vulnerable. The funny thing is that in most conflicts, the army always survives, but everybody else dies. So we are looking at peace in terms of peace building, putting an end to inequalities, and driving something that will maintain a cohesive society where you don't have to fight. People don't have to fight for their rights. And I think most part of the continent now, you could say, Africa has changed in that light. We had three generations of leaders in Africa. First, we have the founding fathers, the Wofford Bwanyi, Senghor, Kwame Nkrumah, who had great ideas, including Mandela, who just died, who had great ideas for the transformation of the continent. They talk about integrating the continent in, economically, militarily, and financially, but they didn't have the means to do it. And all of a sudden, somehow, there was a transition in the 70s, 80s, and every day you had a new military leader running some country. And that crystallized this idea of Africa being unstable, insecure, and not worthy of investment. And that idea went on for almost 20 years. But now we have a new set of leadership. From Senegal to South Africa, I would say 90% of the leaders are elected. They are accountable to the people, not to the West or to the East, as it was in the 1980s. In the 1980s, if Washington liked you, you could be in power for 50 years. If Russia liked you, you could be in power for 50 years. But you know, sometimes they tricked each other, and then you were gone overnight without knowing how you went out. But that has changed. Elections take place, good or bad. Elections are not perfect, but they take place. People respond to the need. The governments now respond to the needs of the people, and therefore, you know, we have a new Africa. And I think in that sense, Africa has changed, and we are capable. We are able to look at our problems from within and say, these are our issues, these are our problems. But we are not doing that in isolation. We know that the UN process is going to be a global process. You're talking about 200 and some countries who have their own interests. Even ourselves, in developing the CAP, developing the common African position, we had those issues. Some people had, well, some people talk about blue economy, some talk about South-South cooperation being more important, some talk about how do you deal with, and other regions came to us with their interests, consumption patterns, climate issues, human security. We say, yes, these are all beautiful ideas. When we get to you for negotiation, we'll sit and talk about those. But for the time being, we'll focus on what Africa wants to do, what Africa wants to go, and what world we want to live in 20 years from now. And we have some comparative advantages as Africans. Besides being 27% of the UN, Africa will be the youngest continent in 20 years. Maybe, say, 5 out of 7 young person capable, you know, of working age will be living in Africa. Africa will still have tremendous natural resources. Africa will be more than 1.5 billion consumers of goods. So these are the issues that we need to think about and we take seriously, and we would like to be able to discuss with the rest of the world. So we have copies of the CAP that we brought. I would like to pass them around and then open up the discussion for the rest of the time. Dan and Jennifer, thank you.
Thanks very much, Dr. Dukule. Really excellent, and I think there'll be lots of questions as well. Kind of what's interesting to me about this set of pillars is that it opens up a whole new range of players in kind of the development agenda. I think the MDGs were very much focused on you know, government to government and or philanthropy to government. Whereas this one, if you talk about structural economic transformation, it's very much investors, banks, private equity, and so forth. If you talk about science and technology, it brings a whole new community. You know, and I think science and tech partnerships from the United States and other countries has been, you know, a promising area of growth and expansion, whether it's agricultural, whether it's health, on a whole range of issues. On the natural resource management, obviously that's a big one. We've been doing some work recently on the new energy producers and kind of the big new flows of oil and gas coming out of East Africa. How will that get managed? Interesting on the capital flight issue, Kofi Annan a couple of years ago through the Africa Progress Panel, put out that excellent report talking about kind of the shell companies in Congo, tax evasion, tax havens, tax avoidance. And I think that at the same time, the G8 in the UK, at the UK summit, was very much focused on setting global standards for transparency, for tax enforcement, for rules on beneficiary ownership of these various companies. So it would be this. I think this agenda blends very well with that one on the natural resource management. I'm going to turn to Dan to see if he wants to take the first question, and then we'll open up. We'll take a couple at a time. I don't think we'll not go. I don't think for the full hour, but. We'll see how the question then.
Thank you. I thought that was very interesting. Thanks for your time. I would be curious about this issue of the role of China in Africa and how you think about it as a driver of development. When I was in Liberia, I asked every public leader I met how they saw China, and I got a variety of very thoughtful answers and interesting answers. And so I know you'll have a view about China as a development actor in Africa. I'd be curious about that.
I have my idea about China as a driver of development, and I think I have also my idea about the U.S. as driver of development, and I have my idea of China being the new kid on the block in terms of development and investment in Africa. They have a lot of cash. One time, I think somebody asked the president here, what do you think about China? She said, well, they promise and usually they deliver. So, and Africa has a lot of needs. And there's a downside, of course, is that, you know, you don't want to be dependent. It's still the same cycle of dependency that, you know, you don't want to fall into. You don't want to fall into China being the factory and Africa being the consumer, and on the other hand, Africa exporting the natural resources to China, because that's really what's happening. If you go to the market of Dakar, where 10 years ago you could buy your handmade things by women in the market, they're made in China. If you, a few years back when I was in Accra, I saw all these flags because of the African Cup of Nations, the flag, the balloons, and I asked the kid, let me see, and I looked at it, it was made in China. I said, why not in Ghana? So, you know, I'm aware of China, we are aware of China, and I think people are starting to think about, okay, China, we have the money, you have the money, you have resources, but Africa has its own agenda, and it should not be driven by the interests of China. It should not be driven simply because China has money, because easy money is also easy problem.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's take a
good morning. Thank you, Dr. Dukule. I'm Barbara Simmons, Dean of International Education at Tubman University. One of the things you mentioned was a new Africa. We just had our first commencement at which President Sirleaf was the keynote speaker. Earlier that day, someone had said we were producing a new breed of student. Can you talk more about the new Africa?
Hi, I'm Alina Jashkovsky. I'm with Global Development Network, and we build research capacity in developing countries. And I'm wondering, in how does this process working on the MDGs work with Agenda 2063 and the African Union vision for the future of Africa? And is the process overlapping, and how's that working?
New breed of students. I think the emphasis is on the quality of education. Tubman University, I know, I was there when it was first opened by the president, and we talked about it. And the fact, for example, that Tubman University is now talking about creating science labs, agricultural labs, and to deal with products that are coming from Maryland, like rubber and palm oil.
Maryland, Liberia,
yes. products such as, you know, rubber, palm oil, and sugar cane that are all produced in Maryland, Liberia, and how to transform those to change the economy and make sure that the kids don't get up in the morning and say, okay, I have to go to Monrovia after graduation to get a job, but I can work in a factory, I can work in an office, and I can work as a scientist in my own county to do something. I think that's what we need to call a new breed of students. And I think that's a big on our president's agenda. And I think it's also part of an essential part of the CAP as creating a new sort of education, a new curriculum that is based on Africa's needs, it's based on where Africa wants to go, and also based on Africa's resources. On the question of 2063 is a long-term vision that is being developed by the AU, African Union, and that is a 50-year plan. It goes hand in hand with the CAP, takes something from the CAP. But what he says is essentially that the 2063 agenda is African agenda. It's not something that we're negotiating. CAP is primarily for negotiation, to have our voice into the post-2015 development agenda. But the 2063 agenda, the long-term vision of where Africa wants to be in 50 years, in 20 years, in 30 years, et cetera, is purely, basically, an African agenda. And that's being developed by Africans for Africa, and that is not really looking at outsiders and say what outsiders can do for us, but rather what Africa can do for itself. And I think what Africa can do for itself has already started. I think the fact that we are able to do the CAP to come up with a common position after 4 years of negotiation and discussions is something that, you know, point to the in a direction of what Nkrumah was talking about, that as long as we have 10,000 different solutions, we will never have one tangible solution. So we have to have one, and Africa has come up with one. I think this is the only region in the world with 54 countries agreeing on the same development agenda, and I think we can sell it. I think, you know, we have enough goodwill out of the world there to be working with us.
Yes.
Hello, my name is Wendy. I'm with the American Red Cross. You mentioned that disaster risk management is one of the priority pillars for Africa. And the network of Red Cross and Red Crescent societies in Africa, they're very strong with disaster risk reduction in kind of cooperation with their communities. That's where the real strength lies, these thousands of branches in Africa working with families and people. Do you feel like disaster risk reduction is being adequately addressed in discussions within the Open Working Group right now? Thank you.
Yes, I think we, as I said at the beginning, we think that transformation of our development processes through economic transformation, taking care of basic issues, you know, can address all these issues. I think we try not to, the MDGs were more focused on social issues and sort of emphasized the social aspect of problems that we will face on the continent. And we're trying to move away from that. Not that we don't think, we think that social issues are not important, but we think that they are linked to bigger problems. They're linked to economic issues, economic exclusion, economic separation between the, you know, the gap, the widening gap between the rich and the poor and all of these things. So therefore, I think the, those issues are taken care of. And if you look into the document, you can also find it on au.org. We have all of those issues underlined, but as goals and as, you know, goals and targets in the document. But I think, you know, we, and we also say this whole thing is about giving the African person his or her place in the world as an actor, not just somebody who's standing on the sideline to watch the train go by.
Yeah, let's take a question there. I have a question that I'll throw into the mix, and maybe it goes to Dan and to you, Abdoulaye, on, in terms of, you talked about the peace and security element, probably getting some pushback from the UN because it's kind of not considered so development-oriented, let's say, or it's a different set of people. But I wonder, where do you think this will face kind of the biggest challenges? And Dan, you've done a lot of work on the UN. You've worked, you just had a dinner with the UN Special Envoy on this. Where do you where do you see the kind of gaps between this set of pillars and what's being proposed by other actors, which I've followed less clearly?
Well, I would just say that I think these are very interesting pillars. I do think that they do reflect much of what's in the high-level panel report. I do note that there's sort of less discussion, perhaps it's in the economic pillar, around rule of law and governance per se. I'm also interested in how the African position is thinking about things like corruption and how, I mean, because I do think if this is about Africa's taking matters into their own hands, which, you know, I think, as you said, 90% of the countries are now democratically elected, and I think it's a very different Africa than 20 or 30 years ago. And I think you certainly, I do think that the brand is, I do think that the perceptions are catching up to the reality of that there's a lot of, been a significant amount of progress made in Africa, and I think certainly people are saying it, and now people are thinking and doing things differently in addition to just saying it. So I'd be curious about how you the issues of rule of law, governance, and specifically how corruption is one of the most important things that in many of the if you look at the polling, I suspect in many African countries it's one of the most important pressing issues. How do you think about that as part of your development agenda? So that suite of issues in particular, because I know that did come up. The governance agenda itself does come up in the high level panel report, and is, I think, is it's an open question whether it'll make the final cut. I hope it does.
I think governance is the overriding issue in all of this is governance, good governance, because we know that without good governance, you cannot do any of these things. So it's there, it's in the back of our mind, and it's also on the table. Every discussion, we talk about good governance. How do you implement good governance? But we look at governance, thank you for raising the issue, because we look at governance not only at the level of the nation, inside a nation, but we also look at governance as a global issue. She asked a question about the Security Council. We say, okay, if you ask me to create a democracy at home, and I create democracy at home, and I'm working with you, how can we work as partners? How do we connect as people who are not big and small, but all, you know, the working on the same level? So the Security Council issue will come up. You say, why do five countries have the right to veto a single issue or any issue that affects 200 other countries in the world? So that, for us, governance at that level is also a problem. It's not just corruption, yes. As Obasanjo said, when there is a corrupt man, maybe somebody is corrupting him. So you got to look at it both ways. If there are corrupt people in Africa, they're exporting money, that are taking the funds from the coffers and then sending them to other banks, maybe the banks are also corrupt. And those banks, who's responsible for those banks, and who benefit from those funds that are taking out of Africa? So we have to look at that process. So that's also partnership to fight corruption, not just looking at Africa and say, yes, Africa is corrupt. Corruption comes with money. It comes with anywhere there's money, there's potential for corruption. Then we say, why don't we sit down and have a forum on corruption? In 2 weeks or 3 weeks from now, we'll have a meeting on the HLC meeting in Monrovia on accountability. A forum on accountability. What is accountability? How do we do it? How do we account to the people, and how do we account to the rest of the nations around us that we have doing everything right? What do we get out of it? So we talk about accountability, we talk about corruption, we talk about governance, but as first inside issues, but also we look at it at a global issue. You know, accountability, if you promise to do, in the MDGs, there are a lot of promises made. 0.7% GDP will go to the development. It has never happened, and we grown enough to know that it will never happen. In fact, we didn't even put in a cap. We say, okay, if people want to help, yes, they will help, but it's not the issue. So accountability is a problem. Somebody promised we'll build you a highway. In the middle of the highway, they say, oh, we have budgetary problem at home, so we can't finish the highway. The government is stranded with a highway that leads nowhere. And who is to be blamed? So who is accountable? So the new global framework has to have an issue of accountability, not just us receiving aid to be accountable, but those who are also promising aid to be accountable to fulfill their promises.
Just on this issue, I think this is a very important point. I do think both with technology and civil society and more increasing democratic governance, that you're having more accountable societies. I see a lot more language about this and things. Accountable governance is sort of UN speak for, aspirationally democratic governance. But I also think your point about accountability for donors is a good one. I do think what I've said here in Washington is the rise of China as a donor means that there are other games in town. And so if we drop the ball on things like not building a road in Africa, well, as your president said, when the Chinese say they're going to do something, they generally do it. So I do think it's going to, my argument has been that China in Africa is something that we can bemoan or we can learn from. And my thought is we ought to become more agile as a donor, think about how we bring trade and aid to the conversation. I don't think we should sell out our principles, you know, necessarily, but I don't think so in general. But I do think that things like being able to bring aid and trade together more agilely, or if we say we're going to build a road, we better do it. Because if we don't, you know, if I'm Liberia, I'll take my problem down the street to the Chinese, and I actually think that's it. So I do think it's a sobering exercise for the donor world to realize that there are other players in globalization that can help solve these problems. So I think it's an interesting point about accountability going both ways.
And if not the corruption aspect tackled, at least kind of transparency is a principle in all of this, both at the global level and at the domestic level. And I think that's what the G8 tax transparency and beneficiary ownership. Dan, do you want to make a...
Just, I think your point about corruption, I think, is a good one, too. I do think the U.S. 30 or 40 years ago was very alone in the conversation of corruption. I'm not saying we're clean or perfect, but I do think we're idealistic as a country, and we pushed something called the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, which I know you're aware of, Dr. Dukule, but I do think that, you've seen it through the OECD process, a raising of the bar and expectations around the world. Brazil has just passed a law. Mexico has just passed a law. The multilateral development banks have a much higher level of integrity standards. So I do think the world, the standards are improving. And I do agree, corruption is a two-way street. And so absolutely, President Obasanjo is right that, and so there are enablers in the developed world, and we have to take a look at that too. So I do think that this is it's a terrible cancer on development, corruption, and it's also a terrible cancer on the success of democracies. It poisons the well of democratic leaders and the chance to make hard reforms. If you're a corrupt government, it poisons the ability to sell to publics, the ability to make hard choices. So I know many countries, it's one of the top three issues. I'm sure it's in many African countries that's the issue. So I take your point that it's a two-way street. Both accountability is a two-way street, and corruption is a two-way street. And so actors in developed countries have to be held accountable as well. So thank you for that. That's an important insight.
And China is a two-way street, too.
China is a two-way street. Right. No, I think that as well. But thank you for putting that out there.
Okay.
We have one here.
We're at 11. I think we had scheduled to go to 11:30, but I think we'll go 15 more minutes if we can.
I'm Mitzi Wirth. I'm with the Naval Postgraduate School. I just want to recommend a book for everyone to read called Fragile by Design, written by faculty member from Harvard and Stanford. And it's all about the link between banking and power. And it starts in the 1500s and said they're absolutely intertwined, have always been, and it's always been corrupt. So the question is, what degree of corruption are you willing to tolerate? I'm impressed by your 50-year project, because we are so short-term in our thinking in the United States. If the stock market doesn't go up in the next quarter, or you over-project or under-project, you failed. And so we're often in the fact that you're thinking long-term and recognize all of these piece parts have to learn how to work together in order to get there. I want to congratulate you for that. We have a set of incentives and metrics in this country that I think are a great disservice today. And I watch all these systems. I would argue, for example, in both economics and political science or international relations in our universities, most of the top faculty learned what they're teaching in the 60s, and their thinking has not changed. They're still teaching what they, because there are no incentives to learn new things. They just have to have whatever they write cited by their friends who are all educated at the same time. Anyway, all I'm suggesting is, well, it's true. It's a real problem for what we're dealing with today. I was in Liberia in 1960. Things have changed a lot. And it's, I think, really impressive, and I feel good about that. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much. My name is Jo Marie Griesgraber. I'm with New Rules for Global Finance. And I wanted to pick up on the tax issues. And I note that in the G20, when they talk about tax and the context of development, they say, well, we really have to do capacity building. And I'm wondering if the African finance ministers and central bank governors and so on, and tax administrators, if on a continental basis you have been able to get together and say, here is the capacity building we want and need, and here are our preferred instructors. If not, I'll work with you.
Hi, I'll try to speak up
Hi, my name is Molly McGregor, and I'm with the Center for Global Development here in DC. And my question is, I was hoping that you would touch on the measurability of some of these targets. I know one of the greatest strengths about the MDGs was that they had these specific percentages and numbers that people could actually tangibly measure, you know, to varying degrees. Obviously, there's some discussion about the measurability of them. But looking forward to the new framework, what has been your experience with the discussions about how we go about measuring these and comparing progress from year to year? Because I think that has been a huge strength. And also, you know, development nowadays is very much focused on the ability to measure impact. And so I'm curious what your thoughts on that are.
Hi, I'm Allison DeMeo from Pixera Global. I have a question also relating to financing. I want to know what you consider the role and impact of the new BRICS Development Bank will be going forward, as it starts in South Africa and then other countries can then apply to be a part of this new development bank. Thank you.
I'll let Dan talk about the BRICS Bank because I'm not, you know, I heard about it. They were supposed to set it up a few months ago, and what it is, I'm not sure. Measurability and data, now we talk a lot about data revolution in Africa that we don't know. The problem has been that a lot of things has happened in during the MDGs, but we are not capable of, we don't have the instrument, well, we have not developed the instrument to measure them. We don't know, people say, well, we have 80% of kids in schools, we have 90% or less, or this or that. But how did we measure them? Sometimes we do rely on numbers given by multinationals, multilaterals, but also sometimes by given by NGOs who have an interest in keeping numbers as they are. So because that's where they get their funding from, we have to be aware of that. So now the finance ministers had a meeting. That's actually when the president first talked about a cap. It was in Abuja. It was at a meeting of the Minister of Finance and Development, and they talked about this issue of capacity building at the lowest level and at the highest level, and be able to be. You cannot be accountable if you don't have the capacity. Sometimes it's not just corruption. It's not. It's mismanagement. Sometimes. Sometimes it's just not knowing what you're doing. Sometimes money goes through the window because some instead of buying this, they buy that. And that what they bought is not what you need to resolve your problem. For corruption, what level of corruption you want to tolerate? A zero level, but that's a dream. Because wherever there's money, somebody's going to try to steal it if they can't get it honestly. So I think that, you know, it's the reality is, you know, measurability, yeah. I think that's...
Okay.
Yeah.
So just a couple of self-promotion things in here. We did a report on governance and economic growth at CSIS, and I recommend if you're interested in that issue, I'll make sure we get you one, Dr. Dukule, before you leave. And then we've also did something on the size and role and scope of corruption as well. So there's something that I just want to reference. But up ahead, on the issue of domestic resource mobilization and taxes, if you look at just in Africa, if I understand it correctly, the UN had statistics that said in the year 2000, something like $100 billion was mobilized through taxes and fees through domestic resource mobilization. And by the year 2010, it was $400 billion. Not all that's, some of that's oil, gas, and mining revenues. Some of that's increased formality and people paying their taxes. Some of that is a rising middle class that excludes all the large amount of leakage and that Dr. Dukule was talking about. That's a lot of money that is being generated, though, by taxes, even though it's not what it should be, because there continues to be tax evasion and other challenges. But are people not paying their taxes? So if you look at ODA, as Dr. Dukule was saying, it's about 50, 60 billion in Africa. I don't think we're going to get much higher than that. I think we've hit the high water mark. So if it's 400 billion of domestic resource mobilization and ODA, foreign aid, is about 60, that's about, you know, there's a lot more of this than there is of this. And so it's seven times the amount of foreign aid. And so I think we're going to see that will continue to rise as you have an increasing middle class. Developing African countries that have discovered oil, gas, and mining in the last 5 years, as Jen has this report on new energy producers in Africa, there's going to be a lot more government money in government coffers. I'm not saying it's going to be a panacea, but I do think it's going to be a challenge for a number of countries. So the problem, though, on this DRM tax stuff is this is not a very sexy or compelling topic. There are no political constituencies in developed countries that are going to get a congressional earmark, to use the American parlance for this, to pay for tax inspectors. OECD has something called Tax Inspectors Without Borders. I mean, that really gets the heart aflutter, right? Tax Inspectors Without Borders. It's darn important, because that's where the money is. But it's very difficult in the American system to find money or force money, because the foreign aid dollars are spoken for. So everybody agrees this is important, but the bureaucratic politics and the interest group politics in Washington to how to allocate those monies go somewhere else. So not saying they're not valid and important projects, and everybody who fights and dies on that hill for their important piece of that pie, I'm sure will tell you why their slice is the most important. But I do think if that's where the money is and there's a lot of leverage there, we ought to be thinking a little bit about how we do it. We'll be having a report on specifically this issue of domestic resource mobilization. If you have trouble sleeping at night, I hope you'll read it. But I do want to talk about the BRIC bank briefly. I think we need to look at the BRIC bank as a purely political exercise. Let me repeat that. The BRIC bank is a purely political exercise. I know that there's a lot of news stories about this, a lot of froth and sizzle. I'm highly skeptical that this is going to go. I think this will ultimately die with a whimper. However, to the extent that we're not tending to our knitting in the United States and other participants in the international system, to the extent that countries don't feel that they're fully participating, I think Dr. Dukule has talked about some of these issues. I'm not going to agree with all of them, but I think he's put a number of interesting issues on the table. That to the extent that shareholdings don't necessarily match the size of the economy, especially in Bretton Woods institutions like the World Bank and the IMF, there's going to be defections from, let's call it, the Bretton Woods system, people exiting out of it. There's been a series of crypto IMFs. When Egypt had problems, the Gulfies played IMF. When Cyprus had a problem, the Russians said, hey, we'll bail out your banking system if you give us a naval base, and playing IMF. There's something called the Chiang Mai Initiative, which is basically an Asian sort of self-insurance IMF. And so there's both a World Bank side to this BRIC bank and an IMF side to this world, this new BRIC bank. A lot of problems. The first is what currency? They say they want to create some sort of new currency. Good luck. I'm not going to hold my breath. I don't think they're going to use yen, given the participants involved. Don't think they're going to use euros. I have a hard time imagining they're going to use the dollar. So if they're not using the dollar, I'll be really curious to see if they're going to do this in rubles. Don't believe it. And so I'm not holding my breath. I know there's lots of press releases about this. I don't think it's real. I would say that the other interesting things are the Fortaleza Agreement talked a lot about human rights. It's really interesting. Lots of words about human rights in that declaration. Now, I don't know. I mean, maybe it's just me, but I'm thinking Russia, China, human rights. So you know, figure that one out. I'm highly skeptical. So it's great, but I'm not going to hold my breath. And then finally, on things like what happens, as Dr. Dukule was talking about, relations are a two-way street. What happens when this new development bank provides a loan to XYZ country and they decide they're kicking China out as the mining investor in, say, Zambia, right? The Zambian election swung, I think, on Chinese engagement. Are they going to pull out or not? And do I really believe the Indians are going to bail out the Chinese if there's a mega financial crisis in China? I doubt it. So very interesting, but I think to the extent that we don't take care of things like IMF quota reform, which is a highly niche topic, but has to do with slight tweaks in the shareholdings of the IMF, then people are going to take their bat and ball and go somewhere else. That's the fancy think tank term for this. But just the thing to remember here is this is a political exercise, in my view. But to the extent that the United States doesn't tend to its garden, and this is both partially a Republican problem and partially a problem for the administration for not selling this, we're the only one of 20 G20 countries to not approve something called IMF quota reform. And like I said, there's lots of technical stuff around this, but basically it's a rejiggering slightly of the shareholdings of the IMF. Then people are going to take their bat and ball and play crypto IMF and try and do things like this. So I think if we were to fix some things, make some tweaks, this would kind of go away quietly, and people ask in a couple of years, whatever happened to that BRIC bank? Now, you can quote me on that, and if 10 years from now this is the biggest thing since sliced bread, you can all throw it in my face and say you were totally wrong. But I'm going to, I'd bet folks a sandwich and a club soda that I think this isn't going to be anything of any seriousness in 3 years' time.
Maybe I would just add that I think you touched something very important, which is the reform at the IMF and the World Bank. I think that's the key issue. Once that is done, you will not need a bridge, you will not need the bridge banks and all these crypto IMF that pops around. So, you know, like Ellen Lagarde said like 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, say, how can we get the U.S. to agree to this one little reform that
requires presidential leadership and requires responsibility on part of my party, the Republican Party. But if it's going to require presidential leadership on behalf of President Obama, he's cut a deal with Republicans. And I think things like, so I agree, you know, I think he should cut a deal and he should send Vice President Biden up there, but they need to find somebody who they can, who can make a deal. They've not spent a lot of political capital on this, frankly, and they've got other things in their inbox. They have tried, but I don't believe they, you know, so it doesn't excuse Republican inaction on this, but I do think there are a number of things I could list for you that, that you could get an easy deal with the Republicans on. But I think it's a political conversation. It's not a question of the arguments or the merits. I think the merits are there. It's a political thing, and so it requires presidential leadership and then Republican responsibility. Yeah.
Okay, we're going to take just a couple more questions, and I'm going to go to that very back room because, yes, sir, and then I think, yes. So let's take these as the last two questions.
Mark Harrison with the United Methodist Church office. And I thank you, Mr. Ambassador. You didn't mention electricity. We have this whole Power Africa initiative, and the ambassador from Botswana said she wished that Power Africa had come before AGOA, so I just thought that was an interesting perspective. And then you didn't say anything about agriculture at all, so there's two questions. Electricity for poor people and agriculture.
Great, thank you. And Miss?
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much, Dr. Akule, for your wonderful presentation. I wanted to ask if you could speak a bit more about infrastructural development as it significantly contributes to the ability to accomplish the goals listed under the five pillars. Thank you.
A good way to end, particularly with the summit coming up. So, and maybe you can just say a little bit about kind of the next steps for this as you wrap up and the president's presence at the summit and what she's hoping to accomplish there.
The gentleman about AGOA before electricity, yes, definitely. I think electricity should have been, you know, I think AGOA was part of those dreamy things that we had back, you know, in this, you know, coming out of the Cold War process. So, okay, we're going to open our market, but with conditionalities. And there were so many conditions that the market, the U.S. market, was not really, really open to Africa. I don't think so. I think, but if there was electricity, and that links you as to the issue of infrastructure. I think infrastructure is still this biggest biggest problem in Africa. Be transport, being electricity, roads, road network between countries, and all of that. I think we still have big issues with infrastructure, and I think if we can come up with something from if this summit. What the president expects, I think she thinks that this is a historic moment, that for the first time, the U.S. is saying, okay, we can deal with all Africa at some point. We can deal with the whole continent, not in piecemeal, but sit and around the table with the whole continent and start a dialogue. What will come out of this meeting, I think it's symbolic. I think the first meeting, such meeting, is always symbolic. It's, you know, saying we start a dialogue. Let's start a dialogue, and then let's follow up with real, tangible issues. Let's set up committees. Let's set up a group of think tanks between Africa and the U.S. Let the partnership be at the level of not only academia, not only at the level of the politicians, but also between the private sector on both continents. Because transformation, when we talk about transformation, we talk about economic transformation, is basically, and first of all, an issue that goes with the private sector. And the private sector is part of our conversation. One of the high-level panel meetings, hopefully in South Africa, will be about partnership with the private sector? What is, how do we build a private-public partnership? And how, what is the role of the private sector in the 2015 post-development agenda? And I think we have that. What do we expect from the summit? I think a dialogue on all these issues, on transformation, on new way of dealing with Africa, and getting out of the cluster of importing oil and gas from Africa to go to different, you know, into other sectors of the market, and also be more aggressive. And I think the U.S. has been very shy in approaching Africa. I don't know, maybe it has to do with our history, the history of the two continents, how, you know, we've been related to each other for the last 500 years. But U.S. has been very shy about Africa. I think there's a time to now to change around and then say, okay, there is an opportunity, there is a market, there is a rural law in many countries, and there are possibilities on the continent that can be tackled.
Amen.
So,
great.
Thank you.
Listen, thank you, excuse me, thank you very much, Dr. Dukule, and thanks to Dan. Thank you all for joining us. I do think, you know, there's mixed feelings about this summit coming up, but I think the point is right that it's beginning of a dialogue and maybe getting over some of our phobias about Africa and our notion that somehow making money and investing in Africa, making money is kind of unseemly for the United States. In fact, investment and trade are the things that are eventually going to kind of drive the transformation. You've got structural transformation as the number one pillar, structural economic transformation and inclusive growth. That puts the electricity issue that you mentioned, the agricultural issue that you mentioned, and the infrastructure issue right at the center of that. So please join me in thanking Dr. Dukule, and we'll look forward to Ellen's presence at the summit.